Hello, my name is Jason Johnson. Welcome to the Cisco NETACAD CCNA Introduction to Networks video series. This video is going to be Packet Tracer Lab 2.1.4.6, Navigating the IOS. So we're going to do three parts in this lab. We're going to establish basic connections, access the command line interface, explore help. Part two, we're going to explore exec modes. And in part three, we're going to set the clock. So the background for this lab, we're going to practice skills necessary for navigating the Cisco IOS, such as a different user access modes, various configuration modes, common commands, and we're also going to practice accessing the context-sensitive help by configuring the clock command. So in step one, we're going to connect the PC1 to S1 using a console cable. So step 1A, we're going to click the connections icon, and that's the one that looks like a lightning bolt down here on the bottom left-hand side of Packet Tracer. And we're going to go ahead and click that, and that's going to give us our different options for different connections. And you can see, you can scroll over here. I've got it on the side of my screen here, so we can see the instructions and Packet Tracer. We have the console connection, we have copper straight through, we have copper crossover. One of the things you want to do with Packet Tracer is become familiar with which connections you have access to down here. So this one, we're going to have the console. So it's asking us to connect the console. So we're going to select the light blue console cable by clicking it. And then if we move up here, you'll notice I've got a little bit of an icon there that shows, it looks like maybe an RJ11 or an RJ45 connector, like an end of a cable. So what we're going to do is we're going to click on PC1 to begin with. And in the real world, you would be plugging that into the back of the computer. We are going to connect that to the RS-232. Now, the RS-232 is a COM port connection on older computers. Most newer computers are going to have a USB connection, and you're going to be using a USB console cable. However, in this case with Packet Tracer, we're going to use RS-232. And then we're going to connect to the switch, and we're going to plug that into the console port on the switch. If you want to know what those actually look like, I'm going to pause here for a second and I'll put up images of each one. Now, what we're going to do in step two, we've connected our cable. In step two, we're going to establish a terminal session with switch one. So we're going to click on PC1. And that's going to open up the dialog box here for us. And then we're going to click on desktop. Then we're going to click on terminal. And this is going to be our terminal software here. And the first question it's asking us here is, what is the setting for bits per second? And the answer to that, bits per second, is 9600. And you do not want to change that. We're going to leave that on 9600. Data bits is going to be 8, none, 1, and none. We're going to click OK. We're going to get the screen for the switch. And that's going to come up. This is going to be our switch information. We're going to have press return to get started. We're going to press return. And it's going to say, what is the prompt displayed on the screen? What is the prompt displayed on the screen? And that is going to be the S1 and greater than sign. We're going to see that right there. That's what's that should be your answer for step 2D. For step 3, we're going to explore the IOS help. Okay, for step 3, we're going to explore the IOS help. The IOS can provide help for commands depending on the level accessed. The prompt currently displayed is called user exec. So we're in user exec right now on our switch, and the device is waiting for some type of command to be put in. So the most basic form of help is the type of a question mark, and what it's going to give us is a list of commands and what they do. So the first question is there, which command begins with the letter C, or capital C? We're going to do case sensitive here. So which one starts with the letter C, and that is connect. If we look right here, that's the first one that starts with the letter C, that's connect. So step 3B, at the prompt, type T, and then a question mark. And what's that going to give us? That's going to say that we've got three commands, telnet, terminal, and traceroute. Telnet, terminal, and traceroute. And then step 3C, at the prompt, type TE. That's T-E, and then a question mark, and then what are we going to get? Now we only have two commands that show up, telnet and terminal, because we have narrowed it down to only those commands that begin with T and E. And so we've eliminated the traceroute command because traceroute starts with T-R. So that type of help is known as context-sensitive help. It provides more information as the commands are expanded. Part two, we're going to explore exec modes, and we are currently in user exec mode, and now we're going to move into privileged exec mode. What information is displayed that describes the enable command? So if we look down here for the enable command, it says that turn on privileged commands. So what we're going to type in is EN, and with Cisco routers and Cisco switches or with the iOS, you only need to type in enough information so that it is not ambiguous, or in other words, the operating system can figure out what you're trying to type. So if we just typed in C at this point, we only need connect because there's only one C command. If we try to type in just E, there's two E commands. There's an enable and there's an exit. So by typing in EN, we get a unique command, which is enable, and so we only have to type in EN. So we're going to now there's two different ways to do this, or there's a few different ways to do this. We can just type EN and press enter, and you're going to get used to doing that working with the iOS. But if we press the tab key, that's going to finish out the command for us. And the tab key is what's helpful for when we're typing in commands and we want to finish them out and we have to type something else at the end of it. The tab key is helpful for us on that. So we typed EN and tab, and what displays after pressing the tab key, and that's the word enable. So that's called the command completion or tab completion. So when part of the command is typed, the tab key can be used to complete the partial command. If the characters typed are enough to make the command unique, as in the case of enable or EN, the remaining portion of the command is displayed. So what would happen if you type TE in tab? So what happens if we type TE in tab? We don't get anything, do we? Because we have two different commands there, both telnet and terminal. So it is not a unique enough command. But if we type TEL in tab, we would get telnet. So the answer to the question on step 1B is there's more than one command that begins with the letters TE because we have both telnet and terminal. So it doesn't provide enough information for the operating system. So the characters will continue to display, prompting the user for additional characters. Now on step 1C, we need to enter the enable command. So we're going to back off there and we're going to enter the enable command. And I'm just going to type EN and press enter. Now, the question here is, on step C, enter the enable command and press enter. How does the prompt change? If you'll notice there, it goes from S1 greater than sign to S1 pound sign, or as some of you know, that's the hashtag for some of the younger users. That's known as a pound sign, but now it's also known as a hashtag. So it changed from a greater than sign to a hashtag. So when prompted, type the question mark. And now we get a whole different set of commands. So if we press enter key, we're going to be able to go one line at a time. And if I press the space bar, it's going to display everything that's there. Okay, on step 1D, when prompted, type the question mark. So one command starts with the letter C in user exec mode. How many commands are displayed now that a privileged exec mode is active? So if you just type C in your question mark, you're going to show 5. Clear, clock, configure, connect, and copy. So the answer to that question is 5. Now moving on to step 2, enter global configuration mode. So when we're in privileged exec mode, one of the commands starting with the letter C is configure. So type either the full command or enough of the command to make it unique. So if we look at our C commands here, we have CON, we have connect, and we have configure that start with CON. So if we look at our two unique, so CON here, we cannot just type in CON because those are both start with CON, but we can type CONF. So if we type CONF, we should be able to get in. So on step 2A, it says type CONF and type tab, and we're going to get the word configure. So what is the message that is displayed? And if we type configure space question mark, we get to see the commands that are underneath configure there. So step 2B, press enter to accept the default parameters enclosed in brackets for terminal. So how does the prompt change? So we're going to type configure. We're going to press enter, and it's going to give us a prompt or a response here, and it's going to say configuring from terminal, memory, or network. So it's asking us a question here. So it's saying, do we need to configure from terminal, memory, or network? And we're going to do from terminal, and whatever is in brackets here is going to be our default. We don't need to type anything if we want what's in the brackets. So we're just going to press enter, and that's going to choose the terminal option. This mode will be explored in other activities later on or other labs. And so for now, we're going to return to the privileged exec mode by typing end, exit, or control Z. Any one of those work. But currently right now, you're going to see how does the prompt change. We're showing S1 I need to highlight there, config pound sign. So by looking at our prompt, we can tell where we are in the operating system. So we're just going to type exit here, and that's going to take us back out to exec mode, and we should be at the S1 prompt sign. Now for part three, we're going to set the clock on the switch. So using the clock command, we're going to explore the help in the command syntax. So type show clock at the privileged exec prompt. So we're going to type show, and using our newly learned techniques here, so we're going to type sh tab, and since show was a unique, so I don't have to type the whole thing. I can just do sh tab, and I can type cl for clock. Now I'm going to show you another trick here too that's not on this lab. If I just type sh space cl, since it's unique, I don't have to type out show. I can just type sh space cl, press enter, and I get into my clock command. Okay. For part three, set the clock. We've done step one, use the clock command, and we've done show clock. And for step B, we're going to use the context sensitive help, and we're going to type clock, and we're going to type enter. So we're going to type clock, and we're going to press enter. And what command shows up, or what response do we get? And that's the question to step B there. And that's percent sign incomplete command. In other words, the percent incomplete command message is returned by the iOS. That indicates that the clock command needs more parameters. It doesn't have enough information. So at any time more information is needed, help can be provided by typing a space after the command and the question mark. So we're going to type in clock and the question mark. Now, again, we could just type in CLO and question mark, and it still works because CLO is unique enough. So we hit, when we type CLO question mark, we get set the time and date. For step D, we're going to set the clock using a clock set command, and we're going to proceed through the command one step at a time. So we're going to type in clock. Now we could just type in CLO, but I'm going to type in just clock so it's following along with the lab. We're going to type set space question mark, and it's going to say what information is being requested. So the information that's being requested is HH colon MM colon SS, and then space and current time. So what would happen, or what would have been displayed if only the clock set command had been entered? So let's just do that. So let's just do clock set and see what happens. So we're just going to type clock set, and we're going to get the incomplete command on there. So for step E, based on the information requested by issuing the clock set command, so we're going to say clock set question mark. So based on that, we need hours colon minutes colon seconds space current time is our current time. So we're going to enter a time of 3 p.m. by using the 24-hour format, which is 1500. There's, you can say 12, you know, 13, 14, 1500. We're going to check to see if the more parameters are needed. So we're going to type in clock set space 15 colon 00 colon 00 space question mark. And it does require more information. It's saying we need the day of the month, 1 through 31, and the month of the year. For step F, we're going to attempt to set the date to 1/31/2035 using the format requested. So it may be necessary to request additional help. When we're finished, we're going to issue the show clock command to display the clock setting. The resulting command output should be this right here. And if you're not sure on how to do it, just follow this step right here. We're going to type in clock set 1500 colon 00 colon 00 31 space January 2035. So we're just going to type that in here. We're going to type in clock. And I'm just going to type in CLO because that's, see, if I type in CL, I've got two CL commands, but if I type CLO, that's unique enough. And then I'm going to type set 15 colon 00 colon 00 space 31 for our month, or excuse me, for our day of the month, space January, or J-A-N for our month, space 2035. And we're going to press enter. Now you don't see anything happen there, but if we type our show clock command, we're going to get this right here. It's going to show us our clock, which should match this example right here. Now, for step two, we're going to explore additional command messages. The iOS provides various outputs for incorrect or incomplete commands, so we're going to continue to use the clock command to explore additional messages that you might encounter as you're learning to use the iOS. So we are still at our privileged exec mode here. So we're going to issue the command and record the messages. So let's type in CL and press enter. And what did we get? You got percent sign ambiguous command colon CL. Ambiguous command CL. That just means that CL was not unique enough. So now we're going to type in clock in command. And we got the incomplete command, percent incomplete command, because we didn't finish out. It needs more information. Now we're going to type in clock set 25:00:00. And what do we get? We're going to get invalid input detected at this marker right here. And it's pretty good at telling us exactly where it messed up. So right here, or at least where it first started to go, where it first started to mess up or could not figure out what you wanted to do. So it's at the 2 right here. And the reason it is because there's not a 2500 in the, there's not a 2500 in the clock. And we only have 24 hours in a day. So at the 2 here, it's saying it's invalid input there. So on the next one here, we're going to type in clock set 15:00:00:32. And we're also going to get here an invalid input detected at the marker because we don't have 32 days of the month. We only have 31. And so it's going to give us an invalid input detected at that marker. Okay, well, this has been the Packet Tracer Lab 2.1.4.6. My name is Jason Johnson. I hope this was helpful for you. If you have any questions on the material presented in this lab, then just leave a comment below and I'll get back with you as quick as possible. Thank you, and I hope you have a great day.